Hello, and welcome to our series on great pursuits. Did you know that there are certain things in the Bible that God commands us to pursue? Not because he's being mean or he just wants to, you know, be the big boss, but because they're important. And because if we don't pursue them, if we don't go after them, we won't experience them. Even if they're his will for us to have, we still must pursue them in order to obtain them. Hi, I'm Bayless Conley. In life, we all face uncertainty, whether it's financial troubles, relationship valleys, a health crisis, or just trying to discover your purpose. One thing is for certain, God sees you. He loves you, and no matter what you're facing, he has the answers. I have just been loving this series that we're on, entitled Great Pursuits, and we have looked at a number of things that in the Scripture, in the Bible, God tells us to pursue, because when we pursue them, we will obtain them. We will walk in the reality of them. But if we don't actively pursue them, we won't experience them. In fact, last time we talked about hospitality, and that may seem really mundane and natural to some people, but we looked at how hospitality, when it's pursued, can be infused with a supernatural element. And in this particular session, I want to talk to you about pursuing what is good. Now, don't turn me off. We want to pursue what is good. But I think you're going to be very surprised about this. This is what the Scripture has to say. 1 Thessalonians 5 and verse 15, it says, "See that no one renders evil for evil to anyone, but always pursue what is good, both for yourselves and for all." Don't render evil for evil, but always pursue what is good, both for yourselves and for all. Let's talk about the first part of that. Don't render evil for evil. Did you know that Jesus actually spoke along those lines in his teaching when he said this in Matthew chapter 5, beginning in verse 43? He said, "You've heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy." Some people say, well, that's reasonable. He's not done. But I say to you, love your enemies, bless those who curse you, do good to those who hate you. Pray for those who spitefully use you and persecute you, that you may be the sons of your Father in heaven, for he makes his sun rise on the evil and on the good, and sends rain on the just and on the unjust. Do good to those who hate you. Don't render evil for evil. You know, it's been said that there are three classes of men. First, there's the man of the devil, and then there's the man of men, and then there's the man of God. A man of the devil renders evil for good. A man of men, well, he'll render evil for evil or good for good. But the man of God, he renders good for evil. The woman of God, she renders good for evil. And the second part of this verse here in 1 Thessalonians 5 and 15, after it says, don't render evil for evil, but always pursue what is good, both for yourself and for all. Now, that can be looked at two different ways. First, for yourself, speaking of the Christian community, and for all, speaking of those outside of the Christian community. In other words, look out for what's going to be good for the church, but also for the community in which the church exists. And I think there's certainly a rationale behind that, and it makes sense. But there's a second way that we can look at it, and it's this. Pursue what's good for yourself, meaning you individually, and all, speaking of everyone else. And I would like to speak about this subject from that vantage point, because in that light, it makes the responsibility personal. The responsibility is yours. The responsibility is mine. I should pursue what is good for me, and for all. In other words, I must weigh in how my actions, my words, my method in pursuing what's good for me, how is it affecting everyone else? How does it affect my spouse? I'm pursuing what's good for me. I'm pursuing what I need. Hey, this is good for me. But wait a minute. It said, don't just pursue what's good for you. It says, and for all. So while I'm pursuing what I need and what's good for me, I have to think about, how is this going to affect my wife? How will this affect my kids? How will this affect my friends? How will this affect my church? How will this affect my neighbors? How will this affect this community, the community that I live in? I have the liberty to pursue what's good for me, but not at the expense of others. Many times people pursue personal advantages and they knowingly hurt others in the process. And they'll defend their position. They'll defend that. They've stepped on others. They've hurt others. And they'll defend it by saying, well, I need this. It's good for me. I deserve this. I have to think about myself. Well, the scripture does allow for us to pursue personal advantage and personal good. But it also admonishes us that in that pursuit, we also need to pursue what's good for all. It adds the proviso, and for all, and that cannot be overlooked. What's good for you may not be good for others in some cases. You know, I have some friends, and they've been married for years. We hung out with them. We had meals with them. We loved them, still do. But the wife decided one day she didn't want to be married anymore. There had been no unfaithfulness on the husband's part. And these are both Christians. No unfaithfulness on the husband's part. You know, he was not neglecting her. I mean, certainly he had his quirks. We all do. Sometimes if you know, the microscope that we look at other people's faults through, if we turn it on ourselves for 10 seconds, we throw that microscope away and never use it again. But what it really boiled down to is she got interested in somebody else. Somebody else started flirting for her, and maybe she was thinking, well, hey, I got married young, and I never really got to experience life like I wanted to. And she started saying things like, well, this is good for me. I need this in this season of my life. You know, what about me? What about my needs? I don't feel fulfilled in this relationship. And so she divorced her husband against his will, and he was willing to do anything to save the marriage, to go to counseling, whatever it took. You know, he realized that he was faulted. So was she. I mean, like I said, they're both friends. We pretty much knew their faults, and I think they know ours as well. But her thing was, well, I need this. This is for me. And she divorced him. But what she didn't consider was, what about the kids? It wasn't good for their kids. No, it was bad for their kids. What about her husband? It wasn't good for him. What about the church that they attended? Well, it wasn't good for the church. It strained a bunch of relationships there. And there were some people that, you know, feel like, well, I can't be with her now. She's with this new guy. It's like awkward. And you know, it was bad. It was bad for the church. It was bad for, you know, her Christian witness to other people that knew she was a believer, and she just dumped her husband, you know, to go be with someone else. Well, okay, she's pursuing what's good for her, but it wasn't good for everybody else. And we have the liberty, and I'm not saying divorce is, that's not my subject here. That was just an example to pursue what's good. You know, okay, this is going to benefit me financially. This is going to benefit me health-wise. This is going to benefit me when it comes to my personal peace. This is going to benefit me when it comes to provision for my life. Okay. We're told, even admonished, to pursue what's good for ourselves. But here's the proviso, and for all. Is it good for everyone else? I was reading a story just recently about a professional baseball player. It's in the 1980s. You know, I mean, when I was a little boy, like most of the little boys I grew up with and played Little League, we dreamed of being big league ball players. And this guy's dream came true. And as a rookie, you know, in the big leagues, he set a number of records, man. His name was in lights. gather momentum over the first years. But any of you that have known anyone that's played professional baseball, you know the schedule is grueling and you are gone from home a lot. Well, his wife was willing, you know, to live that lifestyle. He's pursuing his dream. More than adequate finances are coming in. You know, he's famous. People know his face now. And he actually signed, and this is back mid-80s, he signed a $600,000 a year contract. Now, I know a lot of athletes these days get far more than that. But, friend, back in the mid-80s, that was just a windfall and beyond. And he signs this contract, but he and his wife had adopted four children from different countries. And it turned out that, and they did some of it just out of compassion. They were believers. All four of these children were handicapped in one way or another. So that they adopted four orphans from other countries, and they were handicapped. And they just weren't prepared for the burden it was going to be. And all of the work that was necessary to raise this little family. And after this guy had signed $600,000 a year contract, he walked away from baseball. I mean, the reporters asked him, like, what in the heck are you doing? And this was his response. He said, baseball will be fine without me, but I'm the only father that those children have. It may have been good for him, you know, to get the big salary and to have the fame and maybe to even, you know, have the influence that came with his stardom and his physical prowess. But it wasn't good for his wife for him to be gone. It wasn't good for those handicapped kids that their dad was gone. In fact, they just realized they couldn't do it. And so this guy, what a hero he was. He made the decision to lay aside what was good for him for the good of the majority, for the good of his family, for the good of those little kids. And I'll guarantee you, he does not regret the decision that he made. So, hey, you need to pursue what's good for you. We're told to pursue what's good, but we're also told to pursue the good of all. And we always need to weigh that in. Got quite a bit more to say about this. Man, we've got some good things. Are you ready? So we are told to pursue what is good for ourselves and for all. Those two things. Good for me, is it good for all? It may be good for me, but if it's not good for all, maybe I should lay that pursuit aside. We need to think about both aspects of that. How blessed the world would be if we began to practice this. How blessed the church would be if we began to practice this. How blessed our homes would be if we began to practice this. If husbands, rather than just doing what's good for the, well, I need this, and if you thought about your wife first, if you thought about your children first, is it good for them? If wives thought about their husband and thought about their kids, if the children were raised to think about, okay, you know, this is what I want, and this is what I need, but wait a minute, how's that going to affect the rest of the family? What's good for us and what's good for all? Maybe there's someone in your life right now that you could put before yourself. Maybe there's something you've really wanted. And you've got all your ledgers filled out, and yeah, okay, you know, I got this column filled out, good for me, good for me, good for me. It's not immoral, it's not illegal, it's not unhealthy. This is good for me. Okay, great. But what about this other column? Is it good for somebody else? Put somebody else first. You'll be blessed. When you water others, you get watered also yourself, the scripture says. There's just a spiritual principle there. And so as you pursue what's good for you, and honestly, I believe in having the healthiest me, the best me that I can be to present to other people to be a blessing to them. You know, if I'm running on two cylinders and I got four cylinders that aren't firing and I'm not healthy and I'm tired out. Well, I can't give my best to my wife. I can't give my best to our church. The best gift I can give to our church is a healthy me. But as I pursue a healthy me, I do have to think about how that affects others in the short term and in the long term. I remember one time was with a friend of mine's brother. And I had not met the guy. He's probably 10 years older than me. And we're riding around. It was me and him and a couple other believers in the truck. And this guy's not a believer. And he found out that I had a need. I was actually broke at the time. And I think he gave me $20. It was a lot of money for me at the time. And I didn't know it, but he was watching me. It was a test. He gave me the $20, and we went and sat, and I think it was this little service in a little Grange hall. It was when I was living in Oregon, sort of a feed store, if you would. And somebody was preaching, and they took up the offering, and I just felt God told me, put it all in. And so I put the $20 bill in the offering bucket when it came by. I didn't think anything about it. You know, I didn't have $20, you know, a half hour before, and it wasn't going to hurt me to not have any money, you know, later on. And after the service, the guy's brother came to me and says, I saw you throw that $20 in there. Why'd you do that? I said, well, you know, the need was great. And I just, you know, wanted to help the gospel and what that evangelist was doing. And he said, I want to pray. He actually prayed with me and another person, and he got saved. He says, I told God that if when we got to this meeting, because he said, I knew you guys had a need. He says, if you gave that at the meeting, he said, I told God I'd get saved. And I watched you, and you gave it, and he gave his life to Christ. Yes, we are told to pursue that which is good both for ourselves and for all. But as I pursue what's good for me, I cannot do that at the expense of others. You know, the Apostle Paul founded the church in Corinth, Greece. I have actually stood in the area on the Areopagus where you know, Paul preached in Athens, and I have been to the city of Corinth, and I've been to some of the regions. I've been to the island of Cyprus where the Apostle Paul was there. And, you know, it's really a meaningful to be in those places. But this Corinthian church, they were an interesting lot. He'd won them to Christ, but they had not supported him financially. And he actually wrote to them about the Macedonian believers. Paul had established a church in Philippi. He'd won Lydia, a seller of purple, her household, the Philippian jailer, his household, and a little fortune teller probably became part of the church as well that he cast a demon out of. And that little church there in Philippi supported Paul as he carried on his missionary endeavors in city after city and region after region. They sent aid once and again to his necessity. And Paul, writing to the Corinthians, actually cites the generosity of the Macedonians to stir up these Corinthians, you know, to fulfill their part in taking the gospel to other regions. And here in 1 Corinthians chapter 9, Paul uses some analogies to talk about how believers are spiritually obligated to support the gospel with their finances and with their material goods. So listen to these verses. I want to read quite a few, but they're actually rich, and it lends itself to what we're talking about when it comes to pursuing what's good for you and for all. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, beginning in verse 7, he asks them a question. He says, who serves as a soldier at his own expense? Who plants a vineyard and does not eat of its grapes? Who tends a flock and does not drink of the milk? And they would think, well, nobody. You know, a soldier doesn't serve his own expense. You know, somebody plants a vineyard, they're going to partake of the grapes. You know, tend a flock where you can drink the milk. Of course you do. He goes on and says, do I say this merely from a human point of view? Doesn't the law say the same thing? For it is written in the law of Moses, do not muzzle an ox while it is treading out the grain. Is it about oxen that God is concerned? Good question. He answered it. He said, surely he says this for us, doesn't he? Yes, this was written for us, because when the plowman plows and the thresher threshes, they ought to do so in hope of sharing in the harvest. Now listen to this. He said, if we have sown spiritual seed among you, is it too much if we reap a material harvest from you? If others have this right of support from you, shouldn't we have it all the more? But we did not use this right. On the contrary, we put up with anything rather than hinder the gospel of Christ. And so Paul said, hey, basically, this would have been good for us, but in this circumstance, in this time, it was not good for all. So he didn't insist on his own rights because he had this mentality of what's good for all. You know, I have a friend that pastors here on the West Coast, and I would say within the first 5 years of starting his church, the growth of the church just exploded. I mean, he became well known, and he was on television, and he was getting invited around the world, and he wrote a few books, and he was selling a real lot of books. And he gets more and more invitations. So he's got this growing church, and he's going out. He's becoming sort of famous in Christian circles, got a lot of influence. His books are selling. He's getting a lot of money from honorariums where he's traveling around the world and across the country to preach. But then he had a hard look at things. He sat down and talked to his wife. He had three children. They were small at the time. And his thinking was, hey, this is good for me. You know, I mean, I'm gaining influence. This is good for me. My books are selling, and it's providing, you know, income for my family. And when it comes time, I'm going to have money to put the kids in college. You know, this is good for me, you know, on quite a few different levels, but it's not good for my wife that I'm gone so much. It's actually not good for my kids that I'm gone so much. And it's not good for my flock. It's not good for my church that I'm gone so much. And so he greatly curtailed his speaking schedule, and he answered far, far fewer invitations. And some people said, why won't you come preach for us? And he said, well, look, it's just not going to be good for my family, not going to be good for my church if I'm gone, you know, 2 weekends out of every month. And so he made that decision, all right, good for me, but not good for all. You know, I've had the philosophy, I work hard. I've always worked hard since I've been a believer. I think it's God's way. But I also play hard and I rest well. And I've got a couple of hobbies. I like to play golf. In fact, I love to play golf. And I got some friends that I regularly golf with. I also love the ocean. We live on the West Coast here. I don't live far from the sea. And I got friends that have boats, and we go out and we go free diving and go spear fishing. So I put dinner on the table really often, and it's something that I enjoy. In fact, I call being in the ocean, hunting with a spear gun, my saltwater therapy. I honestly don't look at golf or my free diving hobby as luxuries. I look at them as a necessity. It's good for my soul. It's good for me physically. It keeps me in shape. But I also always have to weigh things out. You know, our kids are all grown and gone, and we got a whole passel of grandkids now. But I still have to think, is this going to be good for my wife? Maybe she's got something she needs me here for today. Or, you know, I mean, I want to go on this 2-day dive trip, but is that going to be good for my relationship with my wife? And so I talked to Janet. I said, babe, you know, I'm planning on doing this. The guys want to go out. We got a great weather window. We want to do an overnighter, you know, out at this island or that island. We're going to go spear some white sea bass, and I really want to go. But is it okay with you right now? Is it a good time? Because I want to consider what's good for her, not just what's good for me. Like I said, the world would be a better place if we adopted this kind of thinking. The church would be a better place if we adopted this kind of thinking. And our homes would be a better place if we adopted this kind of thinking. It should be our pursuit to go after the things that are good for us. And some of you haven't done that, and you need to. You have liberty to do so. The scripture even admonishes you to do so. Pursue what's good for you. Maybe get on an exercise program. Start doing that. That's good for you. Get yourself a hobby. Don't just be a one-dimensional person. You know, pick up painting, or, you know, start taking walks or bike riding, or, you know, swimming or doing something, hiking. Do some things that are good for your soul. Expand your experience. Expand who you are. But as you pursue the things that are good for you, you always need to weigh it out. Is this good for all? Is this good for my church family? Is this good for my immediate flesh and blood family? And I think that God will bless us as we pursue a lifestyle of things that are good for us, that I can give the best version of me, you know, to a lost and a dying world. I can present a healthy me as a preacher of the gospel. I can present somebody that can do more than just, you know, pound on a Bible and quote scripture. I can talk to somebody about the ocean. I can talk to somebody, you know, about boats or about sailing or about hiking or about the mountains or about, you know, the outdoors or, you know, about art or whatever it might be. You know, it's good when I can give my best me. But as I'm going after my best me, I just don't want to leave a string of casualties along the way. So again, the scripture admonishes us to pursue what's good for both you, yourself, and for all. Let me pray for you. Father, I just thank you for those that are watching this broadcast right now. I know it's not coincidental. And I know there are some that have absolutely neglected themselves. They've let themselves go physically. They've not done things that are good for themselves emotionally and mentally. And I pray that you'd give them the wisdom to begin pursuing the things that are good for them, that they can become a healthy them, a healthy physical them, a healthy emotional them, a healthy spiritual them. But Father, I pray that you also give them the compassion and the understanding and the wisdom that as they pursue the things that are good for them, that they would consider also what's good for all. How are my actions, how are my pursuits affecting others? Lord, I ask you to bless my friend. I pray that you'd open the eyes of their understanding to the things we've shared today. And I pray that as we get into the next elements in this series of great pursuits, Father, that you give us all more understanding. Give us a heart to know. Give us ears to hear. Give us eyes to see. And Lord, it will be our intent that as you open our understanding, that we won't just be hearers of the word, but we are going to be active participants. We are going to be doers. And listen, I just want to tell you, if nobody else has told you this lately, you need to hear it. You are loved. God loves you. And for what it's worth, I love you too. You know, I remember hearing the story once about a salesman that came by a farmer's place, and he looked over the farm and the corn was growing up beautifully, and you know, he had this giant vegetable garden, and it was just, I mean, immaculately groomed. And the salesman was trying to, you know, make a little bit of small talk, and he saw like a little sign. It was a Bible verse up over the door of his house, and he figured this guy must be some kind of a religious person. He said to the farmer, "Say, hey, isn't it amazing what God's done here with this farm?" And the farmer said, "Well, you should have seen it when God had it all by himself." Well, God used the farmer. He planted, he plowed, he watered, and God gave the increase. And you know what? We're partners in the gospel. God gives the increase, but Apollos plants, Paul waters. And I just want to say thank you to our partners, because we couldn't do what we do without you. Look what God has done, but we're his co-laborers.
Everyone is chasing something: the perfect job, the perfect relationship, financial security. Many of the things we pursue are good things, but do they have eternal value? Are they really the things that matter? In Bayless Conley's brand new book, Great Pursuits: Chasing What Matters Most in Life, Bayless reveals the things that God says are worth pursuing. From purpose to perspective, happiness to hospitality, Bayless gives you the practical guide to finding the things in life worth chasing, and then the easy ways to pursue them every day. When you go online right now to BaylessConley.com and get Great Pursuits for a gift of $19 or more, you'll uncover how simple obedience to God's plan can unlock the passion, purpose, and healing available to you. What you pursue matters. In order to lead a life of victory, make sure you're pursuing the right things with Great Pursuits. Go online right now to BaylessConley.com to get Great Pursuits. That's BaylessConley.com.
We're uploading new content every week to help you find answers for your life. So don't forget to hit the like button and subscribe to our channel. In the comments, let us know how this teaching encouraged you. We'd love to hear from you. Our prayer is that God's richest and best be yours always.